All right. So today we will begin with a talk on Rivet. Our speaker for the day is Raghav, Kunnawalkam, Elayavalli. Raghav, welcome to the session and thank you for giving the, which I think is already going to be a great talk. So welcome everyone once again. If you have any questions, please type them in the Slack channel. You're highly encouraged to avoid using the chat window in the Zoom for typing your questions. We have a team who's monitoring your questions in the chat window. And when the time is right, we will interrupt Raghav, or Raghav will also be keeping an eye on the questions in the Slack when possible. So we will get to your questions. So make sure everything is there in the Slack. Again, welcome everyone to this session, which is going to be a great session today. Raghav, over to you. Maybe you could start screen sharing.
Okay. Do you guys see my page? Let me get the, I don't want to pull. I want to minimize floating control. Okay. All right. So let's get started, folks. So I can't really see the Zoom hands, but I can. I am also seeing the Slack, right? So let's go. So today's plan, you've learned how to run JETSCAPE. You've managed to run JETSCAPE, at least hopefully a lot of you, right? And then you can essentially figure out what we are going to do with that. Right, that's the plan today. Well, in terms of an analysis, right, you can also use the tools available within JETSCAPE to do your analysis. You saw yesterday in the Jupyter notebooks from Wenbin, like you can make your own plots, run jets, etc. Myself and the crew listed here, we wanted to give you sort of an introduction into Rivet and how that can be used for this purpose, right? So there are three things on the agenda today. Very simple, right? So this is part one. Next week is part two. We go into a little bit more detail. Today is going to be all about what is Rivet, running your first analysis on Rivet. And then because this is a JETSCAPE school and not a Rivet summer school, we are going to do something that Rivet people don't encourage you, but in all hindsight, it's totally useful to us. So we will also learn how to run Rivet with Root. Because if you're an experimentalist, you use Root for your analysis, looking at histograms, et cetera. That's also what we're going to do today towards the end, okay? So before we start, so there's actually a homework that I posted in the Slack yesterday that takes a little bit of time because this is a different Docker container because the dependencies for Rivet are slightly different than the default JETSCAPE Docker, right? So if you go to this link that I already put in the Slack channel for this day, so July 20, it's also in the general, it's linked. So get on that Slack, go to the main README. There are two separate README files for installation. If you go here, you can then see there's a create the new Docker container. On Mac, you follow this instructions. On Linux, you follow this instructions. And given some of you have Windows, you know how to install the regular JETSCAPE Docker, exactly the same, except you replace the name. Right, so here you can see this is actually from Tanner Mengel's JETSCAPE Rivet latest, as opposed to JETSCAPE/JETSCAPE or XCAPE latest, right? Instead of that, you just replace it with this. And then you follow through the instructions, make sure you are in the right directory. So there's a JETSCAPE Rivet user directory. So once you're inside the Docker container, you go here. You clone the JETSCAPE code inside the container. Some of you have asked, should I do this inside? Should I do this outside? You can do either. I typically have two terminals running, one inside the container, one outside, and I'll show you. how to also get the analysis, and we will go into that in detail. And this is the, you know, tutorial that I will actually be following today with you, right? So listen to the talk that's going to happen essentially now. And if you have not done this homework, just start it, right? I will be explaining the talk. The slides are available, because downloading this guy takes a little bit of time, because this is a little bit of a bigger container. I think it's like 10 or 11 gigabytes. It has a lot more prerequisites that you need to install, right? And then you have to get Rivet inside it, right? So once you're inside the container, you go into JETSCAPE FIFO/external packages, and then do, if you are on a Mac, you do /get Rivet. Don't forget this thing next to it. You have to write Mac, because there are certain libraries that need to come correctly. If you're on Linux or Windows, your life is simpler. Just do /get Rivet. This will download and install Rivet. And this will take some time, right? So make sure that this is underway, okay? And then once you have it, source the Rivet install script, and then building JETSCAPE is exactly the same as what we have done on the Tuesday, right? When Chaturanga told you. So you downloaded the code, you create a new build directory, you go into the build directory, you cmake dot dot, which is basically cmake that is using the cmake list.txt in the previous folder with the CXX standard, make J4, and you're okay, right? This should work. We have tested it. As always, in a tutorial, things may or may not work. That's why we have people monitoring the Slack for questions, okay? So this is essentially the step zero of this part, right? So if you have not done this, it's fine. Get started, right? And keep an eye on the talk. So does this make sense? So I lost the Zoom thingy because I hit it. So I can't find out if people have any questions. So if just you're okay, give a thumbs up, and the moderators can tell me that we are fine to proceed on to the next step. And we will go slow today. We can take time. We have two days of Rivet. So you're stuck with me, one day this week and one day next week. So we will go slowly, okay? Are you all set? Should I proceed with the talk?
There are about two thumbs up, one tick marks, three thumbs up now. So there are some responses which are positive so far.
Okay, good. No, you cannot skip zero and install in the old Docker. You need the new Docker. It's a completely separate image. So Baidya, you have to get the new Docker, because there are dependencies that Rivet needs that are not part of the JETSCAPE release. It's a completely separate code base, and we will go into that. Okay, good. So get started on that instruction, and then let's go through the slides. So first of all, I want to highlight the wonderful people of the University of Tennessee Knoxville crew. So Christine's affectionately called Army. So we have Shannon, Tanner, Joseph, and Kristal, who are kind of being the workhorses. Antonio worked on this in the recent past, but he's moved on to greener pastures with S Phoenix, and that's great. So some of them will be monitoring the Slack and will also help you with the questions that you have. All right, so first of all, we are high energy physicists, right? We love our acronyms. What is Rivet? Robust, independent validation of experiment and theory. Kind of a nice acronym, yeah? It tells you exactly what it is. It is independent. right? That's kind of the key word here. That is the operating word, right? It does not have any dependencies on a particular Monte Carlo or event generator, completely outside, right? And the second factor here is that it's a validation toolkit, right? And the only way you can validate your calculation or your Monte Carlo generator, your phenomenological model, is by comparing it to data, right? That's kind of the validation. Or you can also compare it to other Monte Carlo, but if there has to be one anchor point in your study, and that is the comparison to data. And a lot of you asked very nice questions during the last few days, like, what does this look like if we compare to data, et cetera, right? That is where Rivet actually shines. And that's what it was designed for, right? So this little flowchart by the Rivet crew. So I have to actually mention that the slides that I'm showing today, a lot of it is from Christian Bierlich, who is a Pythia 8 author. So he's a scientist at Lund University. And then there's Louis Corp at CERN. So they are both of them are part of the Rivet workforce for the heavy ion side, right? And they have helped bring Rivet into that. But I have essentially taken their recent summer schools and like taken slides from them, and they are absolutely fantastic. So a big thanks to them. So if you are an experimentalist, right? You run your collider, you get your data, right? You do your analysis, you have your plot, right? The plot is how you tell people what you're measuring, right? If you're a theorist or a phenomenologist, you come up with your theory that you think makes sense, right? You put it into a phenomenological model, which in this case means you try and include some probabilistic methods. You create your event generator that gives you some handle on what the final event looks like. You do throw in some atomization models. We will learn more about this next towards the end of next week. And then you do your analysis and then validation. You compare both, right? So that's the key. I also apologize for my intermittent cough. It's almost gone, but I was really hoping it's almost gone. But I have a lot of cough drops and we will get through this. So Rivet, they like to think of it as a language that facilitates the communication between, on one side, experiment, on one side, phenomenology, right? And the whole idea is that there are commonalities in the language that is being used, right? So if I make an observable, let's say, you know, some mean PT, but then I don't tell you what is my PT range, I just use some language. I'm always used to talking about mean PT, and I assume internally in my mind that for me, mean PT is between 0.2 and 2 GeV, right? And maybe I go from Rick and I go talk to an experimentalist at another experiment at the LHC, higher energy. Maybe for them, mean PT is something from 5 to 30 GeV. They measure tracks and they call that a mean PT. We have to have the same language, right? When you make a comparison between experiment and theory, you have to define things relatively the same. Otherwise, that comparison doesn't make sense. That's where Rivet comes in. Okay, so why do we need Rivet? So from their point of view, so I'm also not officially involved in Rivet. I know a lot of the Rivet folks, and I've been working with Rivet since 2015 now. So it's a very useful tool, right? And essentially, if you have some discussion, you say, we go to a theorist and say, oh, well, my calculation describes data better than your calculation, or maybe there's some fight between folks with competing theories. I mean, the way to end that discussion, or maybe start a new discussion, is to have a plot of data, compare the two theory curves, take a ratio, boom, right? You're set. That's your discussion, right? And if you have some particular observable that you want to measure in data, And there's some dependence on how you measure it, right? Let's say you're going into jet substructure. Like this is a field where you're using some reconstruction algorithms, and that potentially you're unfolding, you're correcting for your detector effects with some Monte Carlo. That includes a fragmentation that is an assumption, right? Coming from your model. All of these are dependents, right? If you have an observable that shows a lot of dependence to these, then that might be useful, right? To an experiment to measure it. But at the same time, if your event generator has a lot of these assumptions built in, that might also not be great, right? So you want to study this in an independent way. So you want to run your code, make your changes, and then compare it to a standard set, right? So that's where Rivet is very useful. And you want to also make sure that whatever you measure in the experiment is, you know, this is actually theorist speak, right? Is actually observable. That means that they can actually calculate it, right? For example, something that is very easy for us to measure, right, is the multiplicity, right? Like, I mean, as in like a raw detector, right? Like if you take your jet, you can ask the question, how many particles are inside that jet? How many tracks are inside that jet? That if you have a tracking detector, that is a number, it gives you an answer, right? This is something that is not calculable because the number, there's no infrared collinear safety. You have to include some assumption about hadronization. You have to include some assumption about fragmentation. All of this comes into play. So I already mentioned standardization. The modular part we will get to later, what modular actually means. So this is Rivet in a much more complicated way, right? So let's start over here in the top corner. So HEPMC, right? You've heard in the last few days that you have your event generator that creates output. You can store it in this particular format, the HEPMC format. Rivet is C++ code, right? Each analysis, like as in if you want to make a particular observable or a measurement, that is one analysis, right? You can add more things to that, but effectively you want to contain it such that your analysis tells you one thing, right? You take that code has a few functions in it, right? It has the analysis class, that is basically the default class. You create your analysis that is inherited from the base analysis class, and then you have some initialization function. We will go into it in detail. I'm just kind of giving you the highlights now. And you have a method that gets called every single event. So if you want to calculate mean PT, that's where it goes, right? For a given event. Then you have your finalize method that happens after you load all the events. You do your finalized method. Maybe you want to normalize histograms, right? That's where you would do that. And then you write the output to this YODA file. YODA actually stands for yet another database or something like that, right? Because they decided to create the Rivet authors didn't like root. Right, and they're basically a bunch of theorists who are working on this, mostly Herbig authors and some Pitti authors together, right? Andy Buckley is like the brainchild of this. So, you know, they're like, we don't like using root, so can we use another thing? So then they came up with YODA. So YODA is essentially a text-based storage device for a histogram. It, you know, in root, if you create a histogram and then if you do histogram arrow print all, it prints out all the bin contents, the bin errors, the bin edges. And that's basically YODA. You can go back and forth. You can go from root to YODA, YODA to root, et cetera. And we will see this later on as well. And then you can make pretty cool plots. Unfortunately, we are not going to do this part today. We are only going to make a plot on root side, that hopefully we all have some handle on, and then we'll print it. And then for next week's session, we will figure out how to get this plot, because there's some, I told you, there are different dependencies, right? So we put it together, and most of it already works, which is why we are able to run this. But there's a certain Python library that is having some funny issues that we will figure out. All right. So I saw a question in the Slack. So if I already have an analysis outside of Rivet, let's say within your experiment framework, then for Rivetization of the same analysis, I need to write another analysis code within Rivet. Yes. So excellent, Archita. But you pointed me towards my next slide. So you have to write a Rivet analysis for your observable if you want to use it, right? In terms of you making a comparison. So in all practicality, nowadays, experimentalists, when we make a measurement, you know, within the collaboration, people ask us, oh, can you compare it to a model? So, you know, most of the times, if it's a theory calculation, we send an email to our theorists, maybe I've sent email to Abhijit, you know, hey, can you make a prediction for this, right? Or someone else, and they tell you, oh, okay, here's my prediction, right? But if you want to compare your measurement to Pythia, I mean, you're not going to email Torbjörn, you know, and say like, oh, hey, can you, Torbjörn will probably tell you, Pythia is public, run it yourself, right? That's where Rivet is useful. You know how you did your analysis. You know everything you need, right? So once you create your analysis in Rivet and make it public, it essentially guarantees preservation, right? So the Rivet authors guarantee that they will maintain it for future releases of Rivet. And this also answers a key facet of scientific research is reproducibility, right? So when you have a theory curve that maybe you calculate a Monte Carlo curve and like someone else comes in and then maybe they want to learn how the analysis is done, you don't need to give them your CMSSW code or your Alley root code or your T star jet picos. I mean, these are complicated things. They don't take, but if you know C++ and you learn, you spend a day on Rivet, you can essentially recreate the analysis, right? And this also, this also takes the re-implementation of your analysis by theorists, because we, you know, sometimes when we write experimentalist papers, we put little details here and there. We say charged particles, but then really we mean charged particles that have a certain decay length that is measured in our experiment with a certain time, right? Has certain DCA. All these cuts are sort of complicated, right? If you want to say, give me charge hadron RIA, if you code it in, then the theorists can just take that and run their code, run their Monte Carlo with that code, right? And then this is, you know, helps you create other tunes, and we will get to that later. So I assume that answered your question, Archita? Yes, good. So, why should theorists learn Rivet, right? I think this is sort of a general case, is if you have a C++ interface with Python, this is kind of the state of the art in this case, right? Is someone saying something? I heard a feedback. No, okay, good. So there's some dependencies with the Monte Carlo, with especially this Yoda histogram, the HEP-MC format, and you can just kind of standardize it, right? Any analysis task that you want to do, like you want to basically, let's say you have your model, right? And you're changing something in your model. Let's say you decide to change the value of eta over s. And someone asked this yesterday, if I change shear or stress, how does that change my mean PT? Should both of them change it the same, right? So if you have your Rivet analysis that calculates this, then you can have one set of output from your event generator that has one value of eta or s, and you have another one, and then you can just run the same analysis on all of them because you're not touching the analysis. Then you can ensure there is apples to apples comparison in this case. right? Especially when experimentalists create that analysis and give it to you, right? Then, you know, that's not on you, right? You're just running their code. It actually makes it life a lot easier in that case. So there's also some technical details with how you loop over the objects. There's a very good memory allocation issue, usability within Rivet, things that are of order factor times n, actually reduced to factors of n, like you don't have to calculate things for every event every time. There are these things called projections, which we will get to later in the day. And essentially it is quite scalable. Like you can take your one event, let's say you have multiple analysis, right? You have one Rivet analysis that calculates, I go back to my example, mean PT, you have one analysis that calculates, I don't know, pion cross-section, another analysis that calculates V2, right, from flow. And you have one set of events. In one line, you can just write Rivet minus A for analysis, your first analysis, your second analysis, your third analysis, and then you put your input file, and then everything runs at the same time, right? All of the events are actually synchronized, right? So Rivet knows when you run multiple analysis, all the initialization is happening in the beginning. And for every event, you run over the part inside the analyze function, and then you do your finalize. So it is smart enough to do that together. So another part that is actually quite useful is data synchronization, right? So if you have a publication from your experiment nowadays, they essentially ask you to submit your data points to this, you know, server called HEP data, right? This is a very useful object, right? Because then you can keep all the data points in a single place. Anyone can go download it. They don't have to use this, you know, this old tools where you zoom into a plot and you click it and you get the X and Y, and then you translate that and then you extract the data points from the PDF. They don't have to do any of that. It's already in the HEP data, assuming people put it in the HEP data. And Rivet knows about HEP data, right? So if you say, give me an analysis with this Inspire link, right? You know, the Inspire ID, like all publications have this Inspire I some numbers, right? So if you create it, then it will automatically pull its HEP data. And anytime you run your code with that analysis, it will make the comparison, right? And the experimentalists needn't have created an analysis for this. They just had to put the HEP data, and you can just directly pull it. And we will go through this later next week, and we will do the comparison. So that's part one of the talk today. So just essentially, what is Rivet? What do we do? And then I have a few slides on some use cases and going through a very simple analysis, and then we will start the hands-on. So this part one is, are there any questions? Okay, so I take it everything is pretty clear, everything is simple enough. So I've already told you that you want to test the improvements that you do during your development of your code, right? So if you have a baseline, let's say you have your version of Pythia that is like the default, right? So you can see here this dashed blue line in this plot, which shows you the lambda to K0 short ratio as a function of the transverse momentum. This is at 70 EV. I assume this is a Alice analysis, right? And you can see the data points that are pulled from the HEP data, right? So this is, you don't have to make any of this, you know, set, you know, two panel plot in root and create the T pad. You don't have to do any of that. So it's already done for you. All you have to do is give the data point and it will create this for you. Right, and you can see the default in the dashed Pythia, and Christian works on this thing called Dipsy, that is an update to Pythia, right? That includes something about color ropes and strings and how they interact with each other. I don't know the details, but I can clearly see what Dipsy does to Pythia in this plot, right? Dipsy is this dashed blue line and Pythia is this dotted green line over here. They look more or less the same, but there's some, you know, they're still both off by the data a lot. But when they introduce this thing called ropes, right? That has a significant improvement, at least in some low PT range, but then fails at the high PT range. Like Pythia already gets the high PT spectrum more or less okay in this yield. So this is a useful thing for Christian to know, right? And Rivet told him this. So you have a single observable that you're trying to work, but then once you fix this, let's say you get some model like rope 2, right? Completely fixes it. But then you go to another observable and then you're worse off, right? What you've done is you've essentially overfit to one observable, right? So if you have these multiple analyses set up, then you don't have to worry about overfitting on a single observable. And this kind of takes it, oh, I should just read the slide. This data from CMS and Delphi. Sorry, guys. So in high energy physics, there's a lot of work regarding, this is what I told you, how like things can run in kind of parallelization. There is a Rivet merge that's sort of happening when you can merge different runs together, because if you have lots and lots and lots of statistics, you don't want to essentially run it throughout, right? You don't want to run a Rivet analysis over 10 million events. And you want to create your HEPMC in batches because you run your jobs, you submit it to the grid, yeah? So you can run each of those and then you can do Rivet merge them before. And then Rivet, what it does, when it merges before the finalized method is called. Because you're normalizing histogram, let's say you normalize number of events, right? Doesn't make sense to normalize to maybe number of events or number of selected events that pass your cuts or whatever it is, right? You should add them at the raw level, and then you finalize once you've merged it together, right? So Rivet merge will do that. There's also a lot of work regarding tuning, and we will go into this a little bit later. Once you have an experimental analysis for a particular observable, you can use it to tune your Monte Carlo, right? And this is the recent example that we actually did in STAR, is to create a new tune of the underlying event for Pythia. We called it the Detroit tune, right? You know, there's the Monash tune, which is a city in Australia where Peter Scans is at the university. And then me and a few others started this when I was a postdoc at Wayne State. And then, so here we go, we have the Detroit tune, right? So we wrote Rivet analysis for a whole bunch of RIC data. So we can see here, if you go to this paper page, you will find the link to the GitHub. There's a Brahms data, there's STAR from several years. There's also Phoenix that I didn't include here for the muons for several years of data. And this is one particular observable, right? This is the this is the multiplicity dn charge d eta d phi in the transverse region. So let's say you have your jet that goes in one direction. You essentially look away from the jet and then you create this kind of transverse region where you want to study the underlying event, right? So this is a measurement of the underlying event as a function of the leading jet transverse momentum. The STAR data you can see here in the black points, the Monash tune in blue shows here. We used 5 different underlying event parameters in this tune and we let them play with each other, right? And once you have analysis for all of these, there is a toolkit called Professor. Don't have a slide on that, but you can essentially find out that there is this, you go to this professor.hepforge.org, it creates your lines for the, you know, the bins that you need to generate your Monte Carlo. It handles it internally, gives you the parameter set that you need to run. It uses the Rivet to make the comparison, does the chi-squared minimization over all the different runs, and then it gives you a tune, right? That's what we used here. And this is a very good working example of Rivet. So there is a recent foray of Rivet into heavy ions because, you know, mainly I told you these are like Herbig and some Pythia people, mainly interested in proton-proton collisions, right? Like observables that study QCD, you know, kind of beyond the standard model. QCD is a background, you know, whatever. When you do heavy ions, we need something a little bit more advanced, right? We need centrality. We need event by event correlations, for example, right? We need to be able to run it over several times, because once we need to run, look at the event, create a centrality calibration, very similar to how experiment is done. And that is essentially the key. I told you it's a validation, right? How your code looks compared to how experimentalist makes that measurement. Because if an experiment decides to take centrality in mid-rapidity, right? And then you have another experiment that decides to take centrality in a very forward rapidity region. You know, for some events, those are the same. For some events that potentially very interesting events, those are not the same, right? You get very, very different results if you do that. And that's a problem, right? Even in your model, if you want to compare to what experimentalists call 0 to 5% centrality, it's not enough right now to actually use 0 to 5% in your core, in your overlap of your impact parameter. It's actually better to use the experimental definition of centrality for that particular experiment. Do they do multiplicity in this particular detector that's in this range? Do they do the sum energy in a forward hadronic calorimeter? Do they look at track multiplicity within a mid-rapidity range like Stardust, right? Once you put it in, then you have removed that particular variability, potential variability in your analysis comparison, right? So this is a kind of work in progress, right? This is part of Rivet. This is being updated. Right now, we have everything that we need. Christine was kind of a very big driving force in pushing this forward. This is an example of people using Pythia 8, particularly this Angantyr. And Angantyr is a model within Pythia that does heavy ion collisions, right? It does multi-scattering within your whole nuclei, and it kind of stacks a lot of minimum bias events on top of each other and then connects them with ropes and stuff. It's kind of a very cool idea. And you can see here that they are trying to compare the multiplicity as a function of the rapidity, right? So this is DN charge D eta. You have mid rapidity here, forward, backward rapidity. And then they're comparing to some data with different tunes. And then you can see that, oh, look, if you use the quote unquote Atlas tune, I mean, I don't know what it is, but if you use the Atlas tune, I can clearly tell that is better than, for example, this red, Pythia 8 Angantyr. So you can then start with that. But then if you go to another observable, this is charged particle super rapidity density in a very, very central collision. So looking at this, I can clearly tell this is a asymmetric collision. So it's proton lead, right? From the LHC. So you can see this for the most multiples, the most density heavy events, they have, this kind of slightly off, even though you're close-ish, within maybe 10% here, you can see here in the ratio, you're still maybe, 15% off in the central. So that's a useful thing, right? And then they also talk about how, when you want to make the comparison, how you actually compare, it's important, all the trigger selections. In data, we have a particular trigger in order to collect the data, right? It's not what we call fully, if you're looking at jets, that's clearly not minimum bias, right? If you're looking at even min bias event, that does require two particles to enter into your detectors that are forward and backward and make a correlation, right? All of these can be put in now. So we have trigger projections, we have primary particle projection, what experiments call primary particle, right? And we've had this discussion with theorists, like, well, okay, so what is a primary particle? Well, that's experimentalists, it makes sense to us because we put a lot of cuts to make sure we are selecting a track that comes from the primary vertex, right? That could be other events in experiment where, you don't just collide a single object, right? You collide a cloud, So you can have a collision here, you can have a collision here, you can have a collision there. Those are not the primary vertex. We want the one here. So all those definitions can be put in here. All right, so last part of our tutorial before we get stuck into the hands-on is writing our own analysis. we will also do this by hand, but I want to go through it, right? So we have a multiple, you know, iterating something helps us sort of understand it, right? So we're going to create something called my first analysis, right? And you can see here that it is a class that derives, inherited from the base analysis class. It has a lot of useful information, projections that, let's say you define your default constructor for your analysis. You go into the initialization method that is called once at the beginning, right? You can see this particular piece of code, constant final state fs cuts absolute value of eta less than 1.0. This final state particles, right? This is a projection within Rivet. So it will loop over on the back end, nothing related to you. It will loop over all the particles in your Monte Carlo that are final state. This is where the status code of the particle. Some people were asking about the status codes in the last few days. Usually all Monte Carlos have this kind of procedure, especially when you put it into happenstance, you have a status, right? When the status is, I think, one, it's the final state particle. Now you use that for your analysis. There are other states. If you go to Pythia status code, you look in the manual, you will see all kinds of different tags that the authors have used to call one particle as, you know, intermediate within the shower, or this is intermediate within the atomization, this is beam remnant. They all have different codes, right? So this final state takes that. And when we make our own analysis, we will see there are a lot of different examples to use. You can only get leptons, for example. In this cuts, you can do so many other things. You can do cuts absolute eta less than 1.0 and cuts PID equals block. So if you only want pions, you can only do that, right? Then you declare your final state, you book your histograms. These are Yoda histograms, right? All right, time for another cough. So you book your histograms. In this case, I've defined my spectra for charged particles and neutral particles. This is how we usually define histograms, the number of bins, the low edge and the high edge. So this part actually is pretty comparable with root. And you write your code that runs event by event, right? So this is your code where I get all the final state particles, right? I apply projections, and the projection I want to do is a final state, and it runs on the event, and it's defined by this fs, and this fs is exactly what I define here, right? And I get particles. Then I can loop over all the particles, and if p is charged, there are these functions you can ask for. You can go into the doxygen. I'll also show you. We go into the doxygen for Rivet with the particles list. And if it is charged, you fill one histogram. If it is neutral, you fill the other histogram. That's it. Don't have to do anything else. And then finalizes, you want to divide it by, you want to normalize your histogram to cross-section, right? So you want to get like picobarns or whatever it is. So you normalize underscore H charge PT, that's the name of the histogram. The cross section divided by picobarns, that's the unit. You can write microbarns, and this is already done internally, right? And it and Rivet knows what the cross section is. You know, when you run Pythia or JETSCAPE, it tells you at the very end, it tells you what the cross section is. This will take it out of that FMC file, right? And yeah, now we are off to our analysis. So do we have any questions at this point? If not, I'm going to go here, and then we will essentially take some time. This is where I need every single person participating to tell me that they have done readme underscore install. I will take also mostly all of them. And if something is not working, get on the Slack. We have people ready to help. And if you get today set, right, get the events and everything, then next week is going to be a whole lot easier. And we're going to do a lot of very cool stuff. And we're going to run background subtraction. Okay, I'm looking at the Slack. Downloaded newer image for driver failed program external connectivity on my endpoint. Yes, Rivet is not an event generator. Rivet is a way to analyze output from an event generator that is not dependent on a given event generator. That's all. Okay, so there are people having issues with the container downloading, and I would say it's because some other people have been able to download it. I would simply suggest deleting what you have and then issuing this command again. Okay, is this visible to people? Do I need to make the slide, the text font bigger?
I think it's good.
Okay. So this is a big container, guys. So you may need to kind of make space in your system to download this container. So you are inside my JETSCAPE Rivet and try to do step one. It says I do not, okay, let's go through the list, guys. Step 0A, did you all see this? Once you get the container, this is where you are. So if you do pwd, you're inside home JETSCAPE user. That's where it takes you by default, right? So we can fix it, but I just didn't do this at this point. You can go, just copy this link, cd home JETSCAPE rivet user. We have to get into that directory. And there, you will have write access. So if I do test.test, you can see I created it there. Okay. So Isabel, I assume that is the issue because I ran into the same thing recently as well. Because I can show you, if you go into it'll tell you permission denied. That's kind of a funny thing because it doesn't know about that directory. So you have to go into Rivet user. Okay. So inside JETSCAPE Rivet user, you should be able to download all your code, and I can, you know, get this one. We can actually get this container as well. Not container, this whole GitHub page. We can get this repository, that's what I want to say. So I'm actually going to do that now. I'm going to go to code, I'm going to copy this. And then inside here, git clone. Right, see, now I have this directory tutorial that has a whole bunch of my first analysis, et cetera, et cetera. So we're not going to use that right now. We're going to follow the instruction inside here, readme analysis. So this is where we are going to start. So I just did step zero for you guys. Okay, how's everyone feeling? Should we get started? We have time. Don't worry, we'll go slowly.
Maybe we can ask everybody who was successful to put a thumbs up in the chat and keep it there for a while. Would that be helpful?
Yeah, I can also open up the, oh, that's the chat. Participants. So that was someone did a poll, maybe it was yesterday or the day before, I don't remember. Could we have that same poll basically saying things are downloading, or maybe I have everything ready, things are downloading, installing, and I have an error. Could we just have that poll to see how we are doing? That probably would be easier.
Raghav, can you see? I just ran it.
Yeah, I'm looking at it. I don't know if you guys can see it, but it's on my screen. So if I'm sharing it, then you can probably see it. Also, this number, so something's wrong with this. Oh, here it says participated, and then this is answered number. Okay, so that doesn't make a lot of sense. This number is most useful. Okay, for folks who are stuck, please put your message. Is it stuck as in like it's downloading, or is it stuck as in like you don't know what to do, right? Then in that case, you should put your questions in the Slack. And I think, Isabel, I did try to answer this, but did you have a follow-up? Like, are you still in this directory and not able to create stuff in your computer? Okay, so the way this command works, right? So let's go into here. This is the Docker command, right? This directory right here, before the call, before the, I never remember this. This is a colon, right? So before these two dots, this directory is the location on your computer, right? And then the one after that is you're taking that location and putting it inside the container, right? That's what this command means. So if you have write access in whatever contain, like whatever directory you have made, so you should first cd into that. So if you don't have that directory existing, right? So this is my version, like, so don't just copy this and paste it. You should have your own version, right? That we had in the, let me close this, in the install. You can see here we went into our home, we make their JETSCAPE Rivet Docker CD into JETSCAPE Rivet Docker, and then we told the container to use this this directory, right? So if that doesn't exist on your computer, then you won't be able to run this. Well, you'll run it, but the container will not know where to put stuff. So maybe show us the full error and the code that you put in next time. You know, when you have an error, show us the full terminal, like, you know, basically copy from like here to here, right? And then post it. And then we can try and help. Yeah, thanks, Ritu. That makes sense.
When do you want the poll to stop?
Sorry?
When do you want me to close the poll?
Sorry. Yeah, I didn't. Let me see. Yeah, I think it's fine. We have a good bit of people participated. So I still see this number has gone up now. So it's 6. So put your messages and the error messages and we can try and help. Okay. So let's close the poll and then we can essentially go into our short break now. I need one because I need another coffee. And then we can come back in. Ritu, what was the time? Did we say 10 minutes? That can also help people get caught up in this case.
Let me double check. I think it was 15 minutes. I mean, Q&A session is now for 20 minutes, and then we break for 15 minutes as per the schedule.
Well, let's do the break now. I mean, people can ask questions if they want now, but I think we should take a break now before we jump into the analysis, and then we can hopefully get people to maybe have everything done from the install part before we get started on the next step, which is really kind of open-ended, right? Because I have one template analysis and one, you know, and then we can make whatever analysis we want, and you can create how many events you want, and you can look at new things, and we can make a poll of what observable you guys want to find, and we can also code that. So then in that light, I suggest we take a 15-minute break, get another coffee, get caught up, hopefully some people, and then we can get back into the coding part.
Sounds good. So we all reconvene at 10:15 Central, or 10:15 Eastern and 9:15 Central time. So maybe exactly in 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds good.
Yeah. In the meanwhile, I will be monitoring the Slack. So Silas, you've been writing something for a while. And don't worry, do not apologize for your cat sitting on your terminal. That it's the cat's right to sit on the keyboard. Yeah, so nice question. So the question is, Silas says that Herbig uses Rivet in some capacity, internal validation, or just to make sure Herbig output is in the proper format for later use with Rivet. And so Herbig, in order to generate events, does not use Rivet, right? You can build Rivet with Herbig. Like when you do the Herbig bootstrap, there's a flag to turn on the Herbig install. No, sorry, the Rivet install, right? But that is only for your benefit when you do the analysis, right? You can write your own C++ code to read Herbig output in the ASCII format to do analysis. But then you will have to write another code to use within Pythia analysis to write the same observable, right? So if you don't want to do that, then you can write both of them to the HepMC output. And then you have two separate HepMC files. And you can write your same analysis and then run it on both of them. And run it on not just both, you know, n number of outputs, you know, n number of event generators, run it on all of them, and you can compare them. And you can create the whole suite of lines in your single plot that tells you how things change. So that's what it's useful for. Right, let me quickly stop my sharing here and then I will be back in 5 minutes after I quickly make myself a coffee. Okay, I'm back. So, yes, okay, nice question. We can definitely do tag jets. In fact, as you will see, the example that we will create, the example Rivet analysis, comes with an example on how to do B tag jets with muons. So it's like four lines of code, right? That's incredibly simple.
Great, thanks.
Yeah. All right, we got 5 minutes till we restart. So, we obtain parameters by fitting azimuthal correlation yields with possible to use fit functions. So this is actually going to come in a later use. So there are pre-installed projections within Rivet to use correlation. So there's some example Alice analysis that have really used V2 and V3, and you can look at their code and it's all public, right? And that tells you how to do it. But here's where you can get sneaky. You can also use root functions, like fit functions that we know and we have used in our analysis in data. You can use that within Rivet. And we're going to see how we can use root within Rivet for your own analysis, right? This will never get approved. Like, Anthony Buckley will not approve your analysis if you use root. But that's not sort of the goal, again, as well, right? Because this is not an experiment school where I'm teaching you how to do an analysis in Rivet for your experiment. Yeah, but that's a separate thing. Here we are going to essentially use Rivet as much as we want to, right? And a lot of that is analysis purposes. I use Rivet a lot, right? And I have TF1s in there. I have soft drop and fitting, and I do all kinds of stuff in there. So if you want, you can do it. It's open source. Okay, then let me get started on the sharing. So where's the... All right, so folks who said that they are almost there. Are you there? Wait, how do I see? What happened to my... I can't see the participant list, so it's fine. Oh, there it is. In fact, what I'm going to do now is to make sure that let's make this simpler. JETSCAPE, summer school, tutorial, not tutorial.
If people don't
okay, so folks, I don't know if you are able to see what I just did, but I put a sample HEPMC file from JETSCAPE proton-proton collisions, RIC energy, just in case that none of that is working at this point, you can follow along. You can download this HEPMC file. Hopefully you're able to make it yourself, but you know, you download it and then you can run Rivet after you download this file on top of it. Okay. So just as a short backup. Okay, so let's get started then. I assume everyone's back. So we have now gone into the Docker container. I am inside this home JETSCAPE Rivet user directory, right? You're able to git clone JETSCAPE FIFO. If you run get Rivet, wait, it's 15 minutes, right? Didn't we start? Is it? Ritu, just tell me, I'm here.
Sorry, didn't mean to interrupt you. So I think as per our schedule, we are supposed to start the hands-on session at 10:30 Eastern time. So we might still have some minutes in case people are out on break and they want to still join us around the time published in the schedule.
Okay, no, that's fair. That's fair. Yeah, until then, you know, I hope you can use the time wisely to make sure everything is up to date in far as getting your JETSCAPE files, compiling JETSCAPE, making sure you have inside your build directory, you have all of the executables, this run JETSCAPE domain executable. Yeah.
Or if somebody has any additional questions, we can perhaps use this time slot to address those.
Several people are typing. Let's go. Okay. Karen has a question. So I'm looking at the sample, my first analysis. What does declare do? So you want to look at, let's go here. Okay, let me also make this bigger. I have to Emacs, easily Emacs. You're asking about this, right? So they essentially use strings to associate different projections in Rivet. So other than telling you you got it right, you use the string and then you can use it to get a list of particles here. You can also create another event, for example, from, you know, so this is the main event, right? You can create a sub event for whatever analysis that you want to do, right? Let's say you want to look at events that are separated, well, not event, but like, you know, sub events that like we do in heavy ions that are separated by like large, like rapidity gaps. And you want to run the same analysis in both of them. You can create your particle list from that event list by just applying some cuts, right? You can use, so this is a Rivet event object, right? So if we go to our rivet.hepforge.org, that's the main website. You go to your doxygen code on the left. The key classes are listed here. You can go to the event class. And you can see there are a whole bunch of functions that you can do. The constructors, you can create different selection cuts. So this is going on the HepMC gen event, right? So you can use these kind of fancy analysis on that if you want, and then create a new projection. But it still uses the same cuts as this projection. So that's probably why they want to create this string tag. But that's just my guess, and I think that's how the code is set up. Sorry, I don't have a much better answer. So Ajita, don't worry, I didn't know what a bootstrap was. People like to use bootstrap for a lot of different things. But in this case, a bootstrap is a particular script that does everything for you. So there is a script. If you go into this Rivet page and you say, you go to getting started, installation, and then they tell you download the bootstrap script, and it's literally called Rivet bootstrap, and then you run it and then it installs. So this get rivet.sh that we told you actually does this. It's just a fancy way of putting it inside. Okay. Any other questions?
All right, we're almost there. Ready to begin the hands-on session, Raghav. Thank you very much.
Wait, you said you were almost there, or do I have
permission to go? Oh, we are there. We are now at exactly at 9:30.
All right. Okay, so folks, let's get started. So I assume that you have done README install. Now we're done. We have built JETSCAPE, we build Rivet, and your inside README analysis, right? So first things is to get this container that Crystal, this repository that Crystal made that I showed you before we went on break. Just git clone this tutorial directory and you will have a directory here called tutorial. There's stuff in there that we will use for comparison. We won't use it right now, right? So first things first, does your container, when you're inside the Docker, does it know about Rivet? So when I typed in which Rivet, you can see it didn't know anything about Rivet because it is not sourced. You have to source Rivet in order for the system to know where to find it, right? And Rivet is inside. So if you go inside this Rivet local, you can actually just do source rivet.env.sh, right? From this Rivet JETSCAPE user, you do source rivet local rivet.env.sh, and that's done. Now if I do which Rivet, it tells me exactly the executable that is inside local binary Rivet. Okay, so now we're good on that regard. So this is my Rivet analysis that I made yesterday for the testing. So I'm going to move this to here, and then I'm going to follow along this information with you guys. So I'm going to create step one. We are now in step 1A. We're going to make a new template analysis for Rivet, right? So we're inside cd home JETSCAPE user. We already did that. So we're going to do make the Rivet analysis. You can see there it is. So now we cd into the Rivet analysis. And I'm also copying and pasting. You can also do that. And this is now empty because we just created it, right? So now let's create our new analysis. So this is rivet-mk for make analysis. And then I'm going to call it my first analysis. Enter. Okay. So it says writing templates for my first analysis to this particular directory. It tells you how to compile this analysis plugin, right? Says Rivet build and then Rivet followed by the name of the analysis .so. So that's the binary plugin. Rivet is very picky about this naming convention. You have to name this library like this. You have to do capital R, small I, V, E, T, and then the exact name of your analysis. Otherwise it will complain, it'll yell at you, right? And then the .cc file. So let's see what it actually created for us. It created three files, right? A .cc file, a .info file, and a .plot file, okay? So let's now, okay, so this is now my Emacs in my computer. So I'm not inside the Docker when I do Emacs. So the Emacs I open on my computer, I do the analysis inside Docker. This is just how I work. And if your way is to do VI, whatever, in the terminal itself, do that. I am just a very firm believer in the church of Emacs. So this is what I do, right? So I go into my first analysis. And let's look at all the things it already gave us. right? So first things first, a whole bunch of include statements. This is the base analysis header, right? The final state projection that we used. You can see FastJet is already in there as a projection. There is this thing called dressed leptons, missing momentum, and a direct final state. We'll see what it is in the definition of the example below. So missing momentum, for people who maybe don't know, this is experimental language for supposedly neutrinos or things that we can't really measure, right? Things that leave a gap in our detector, in our measurement, right? So if you reconstruct all the transverse momentum of everything that you see in the event, they should sum up to zero or very close to zero, right? Because originally your beams are in the Z direction, there's nothing in the transverse direction other than some intrinsic KT stuff. But I mean, let's just do first order, right? If you're missing like 50 GeV in one direction, that means you had a very high energy W or something that decayed to an electron and a neutrino, and then you lost the neutrino because you didn't reconstruct it. You found an electron. Then by adding up the electron and the missing momentum, you can reconstruct your W, get your invariant mass. So this is mainly for the high energy people. Okay, so all our code is inside the Rivet namespace. We have our class that is derived from the base analysis class. We have our constructor. Here we go. This is the final state projection that the code gives you, right? And it uses absolute value eta cut between plus minus 4.9 in rapidity, in pseudo rapidity. I mean, no detector measures up to this rapidity. So because I was in star, now in S-Phoenix also is 1.0. If you're in CMS, or I think you're in Alice also use this. CMS, maybe you do 2.5, you know, whatever, within your experimental acceptance. You can also, if you want to look at only forward physics, you can do this, right? You can also do different selections. There's also different PT cuts, right? And you can say less than 1.0, and you can do cuts, PT greater than 2.0. Let me move the camera. Right. This means that you're only selecting all particles above 2 GeV. Right. Because this is, you know, Rivet code, and I don't remember this off the top of my head, we can go to the Rivet Doxygen page. And then we can search for class index. See, what did they call it? Let's go. Where is this? Rivet. That's. Ah, it's a, okay, so it's a namespace. There we go. See, you can use PT. You can use capital T or small t. You can use ET cuts. You can say the, you know, certain energy cuts. You can also select on absolute value of the charge, and you can then add them together as you would, right? So if we do this, then we will only get all particles within this rapidity range, within this PT cut in our final state projection. So we can do that later. So then they already tell us an example projection, how to get jets, right? You create a projection called fast jets. You say jet FS from your final state. So that's the input to this guy. And then this is the jet algorithm. You use anti-KT. This is, you can also have, you see the fast jet namespace here. You have the radius R0.4. You can tell it to include or exclude the muons that you measure, because if you don't have a detector that can measure muons, well, then, you know, you can do this. say that you don't want any invisibles inside your jet, like, do you want to include neutrinos, right? Because our Monte Carlo event generator gives us neutrino, but usually we can't measure it, so we exclude the neutrino, right? So you can do that. And then you declare your final state jet FS with this. We are not going to do jets right now. So I'm just going to cut this, paste it here, and then say FS, and then just kill this. Okay. And you can see some examples of other final state projections. So they wanted to get, if you want to do photon jet analysis, right? Like high energy photons scattering off of a quark in a QCD, quantum scattering, right? You can get that by saying that the cut's absolute PID is the PID of a photon. So you don't even have to remember what the PID of the photon is. You can also do bare leptons. Give me all the muons and the electrons that you find. So we don't, again, need this right now. But if you're trying to measure, if you're trying to make a calculation of, let's say, the dilepton invariant mass at different energies at Rick, that is supposed to tell you about the chiral, kind of the chiral condensate, you can do this analysis. Look at the muons that you get, the leptons that you get, pair them, plot the invariant mass at intermediate mass range, and then boom, you can see if your code gives you exactly what you want. We don't need this now, so we'll just kill it. You can also create new cuts, right? You can say that the lepton cuts has to be within this range, and then you can create certain new projections that this dress leptons has to be within your photons, your bare lepton cuts, and they have to be within some certain angle. We don't need this right now. We can just kill all this, and here's a way in which you can define your missing momentum. You can kill it for now. Make the analysis very, very simple, right? So this is how we can now book histograms, right? So we will get back to this part later. We'll kill that because that takes it directly from the HEP data. So if you ever had to submit HEP data for your measurement, you have to give it in these X, Y, Z columns, right? Like 0X1, 0Y1, X01, Y01, Z01, and then, you know, or D01, and then you pull it from that table. So you can say the PT is the table 111 in my HEP data, and then if you fill it in, it will take the binning, the exact binning and the values, and it will make the comparison itself. We'll do this later. We don't need this for now. So I want to kill it. There are different ways in which you can create binning for your histogram. So you can create custom binning, right? So this is how we do it in Root. Usually you tell it the number of bins, the low edge and the high edge, or you can create log bins between these two values that are equidistant in log space, or you can give it an array for your binning, right? So we are going to run this collision, we're going to run PP collisions from JETSCAPE at Rick energies. And we are going to just look at the pion spectrum or charge spectrum, whatever it is you want, right? Let's start with just simply the charge spectrum. So I'm just going to say charged particle underscore PT. And this is just my convention. I always copy and paste this so I know exactly what it is I'm doing. What each histogram is, and this will also show up in your YODA file. And obviously we don't need to go to 100 GeV for our bins. If you just say 10 GeV, that's more than enough, right? And we can do 20 bins from 0 to 10, and I don't need this right now, so I'm just going to kill it. Just one histogram for now, okay? So here we go. We created a final state. We declared the final state projection. We booked our first histogram in Rivet, and now we're going into the analyze function. Any questions regarding this first step? Pretty basic, right? Ah, yes. So watch that. You don't have to use their own Rivet because the jets that they used in there was their own implementation. So that has some parameters and stuff that you can declare it. But I'm the type of person that I really like to have full control on the code that I do. So I will usually use this final state, get my jets, get my particles, and then run everything like I do in my experiment analysis, except the fast jet, the pseudo jet vector is not tracks, but particles. We'll go through that example later. If we have time today, we can also go through today. And I can show you how we did it in that Pythia 8 Detroit tune that we did. We used a jet mass measurement from STAR. We wrote a Rivet analysis for that. And then we used that in the tuning. So that also shows you how to get the mass, how to run different jet radii together, how to do grooming on top of it, et cetera. Okay. So this one tells you how to get the projections, right? We don't want lepton projection. We want particles. Right? Final state event, we called it FS. That's it. Now you have final state particles inside this vector. Right? This is a, so particle is a, so this is a Rivet convention. So let's go back here. You see the key classes is there's this base particle class. Right? This inherits from, you can see from a HEPMC gen event particle object, and it uses all of that information. It has a PID, four momentum, four vector. You can actually get a pseudojet from it, which is very useful. You can just typecast it as a pseudojet and it will retain all the information. And for this pseudojet, you can also create a new user index. Like if you know what it is, you can set its charge and all this stuff that a pseudojet doesn't usually have. You can also get its PID, you can get its charge, but a vector of particles. So in C++, if you have an undefined array, you can start the undefined length for an array, you can define it as a vector. And if you create a vector of particle, in Rivet, they are called particles, right? So it's kind of simple there. So jets are a vector of this class jet. You don't have to define std vector bracket fastjet :: pseudo, you don't need any of that. Just do jets. It's very simple. Okay. So this gives us all our particles. Let's just see what the example is they give us here. Retrieve the cluster jets stored by PT. So you can see here jets equals apply fastjet projection on my event that was called with this tag, with the string jets. And then I put some cuts on it. Jets sorted by PT and cuts greater than 30 GeV. Kind of a very speaking knowledge, right? Like, it's like a speaking language. You kind of tell it what you want, right? We don't need this now, so we'll just kill it. And then it says remove all jets within DR less than 0.2. Yeah, we don't need that anymore. Here you can see it's actually doing ghost association. So very similar to what you're asking, Archita, or even Yasuke, if you want tag jets, right? So they define B jets as having a B tag, right? With the PT greater than 5 GeV. And you can go into this inside Rivet, what it actually does. You can do Rivet, doxygen has B tag. What is exactly called? As B tag. Jets. Let's see. Okay, here we go. And then inside the jet, maybe this is it. There is a B tag option. So B particles that are tagged to this jet. So it's by definition, you already have B tags and C tags that you can do, right? So it searches through the adds B-hadron tags to be within your as a ghost particle when you reconstruct it, right? So again, more complicated. We don't need it now. If for some reason you need to kill event, right? If you find no particles in your event, when you run your simulation within your acceptance, for example, right? Let's say you have a funny acceptance and you want to find particles in that particular range. If you don't find anything, you don't want to keep doing the analysis, right? If you have empty vectors, there's no point in doing the analysis. So you can just veto events. We are just looking for all particles right now. So we don't care about this. So we'll just kill this. You can apply a missing momentum cut if you want. If there's something less than this, kill it, right? We don't care about that. We only want to fill histograms that have all the charged particles, right? So now we need to make sure our comments are useful, right? So now loop over particles and fill in the charged particle PT, right? So the way to do this right, so you just run a loop over this kind of iterator P that loops over all the particles, right? Let me just double check that this is indeed what I did in the analysis code. So we have my first analysis. Yeah, I called it FS particle, so I did that, right? So we have to just make sure that we have exactly the right one. And then this is being taken as a, not as a pointer, but as a direct object, so we can just do the ampersand. Okay, and now we change this to fill P, and now we have to ask if it is charged. If P dot, let's see what the function is, for the particle class, there should be a function is charged. Is this particle charged? Okay, and it's a Boolean. That's great. So we just copy it, say if P dot is charged, then I have the name of the histogram, copy and paste it here. And I have filled in it. Now filled it, that's it, I'm done. And I've said what unit I want this, right? In units of GeV. So now in the finalize section that happens, so this blob here runs every single event, right? As I said, once you're done with this, you can decide how you want to normalize it, right? If you just write normalize, it just scales it to unity, the overall integral. You can normalize by the cross section in units of picobonds. If you're putting some cuts, right, you want to generate to the selection that you found, not to the overall inclusive selection. Let's say you want to do that, right? Then you can scale the histogram by a particular number and the sum of weights, right? That's what this thing calls. So each event, when it produces in a Monte Carlo, will have a certain cross section weight, right? So you can then say, give me the sum of weights, and Rivet internally calculates it. You don't need a counter or anything inside here to deal with that. You can, if you want, like there are these string counters, and you can just do underscore C fill. And I'll show you an example of how we did that. You know, you can just do that. And then it's more or less simple, right? Yeah. But we are only wanting to normalize to the cross section. So I'm going to kill all of these things. And then I need to replace the stuff inside the bracket in the quotes. Okay, so that's good. And you can name histograms. So you can see these are named as essentially strings that have certain histograms or profiles that you want, or counter objects. We don't need any of those, so we kill it. And that's it, guys. You have declared your first Rivet plugin, my first analysis. And pretty simple, right? In order to get just the charged particle. So save it, And now let's go back to our terminal and see this is now changed. And now let's build it. Rivet, and Rivet actually told you how to build it. So we don't have to write anything. You just copy paste it. So this Rivet build command, this is what it does in the background. It shows you. So it compiles it as a regular C++ code. This is the executable output. Some flags, these are the several include flags. It knows where Rivet include stuff is. Using the HEPMC output that we want. All the useful stuff inside Rivet. FastJet, see, you can see it includes the libraries from FastJet tools. Plugins, contrib. So if you want to make a plot of the Lund plate, it's right there, right? You can just create it. FastJet is already in there, right? All right, good. We have created our first executable. So do people have it? Give me a thumbs up if you have your Rivet executable. Karen, good job. Silas, excellent. Yasuke, people are putting thumbs up real fast. Very good. Isabel, it's finally working for you. Excellent. I am very happy. Very good. All right, so if people are not getting it, are you getting any errors, or are you getting any issues? I'm not seeing anything in the Slack, so please post it there if you're running into any issues. All right, good. Then let's go back and create our HEPMC file that we want to analyze it. Oh, there's a... Oh, okay. Then you guys can figure out the issues. All right, so need another. All right, so let's go into the JETSCAPE. In this case, JETSCAPE FIFO. So build, this is how we run JETSCAPE, right? You do this run JETSCAPE executable with a certain config file. So we have given you, if you go into this config directory, this JETSCAPE FIFO.xml. I have not mentioned FIFO during this entire thing, even though it says JETSCAPE FIFO and everything, the FIFO is in there. FIFO is first in, first out, right? That's what it means. So the way in which we have to do this, and we'll talk about this, you know, right now, we'll spend a few minutes on it, is that when you start running Monte Carlo and doing analysis on those events, it's a serial process, right? You run your Monte Carlo, you know, it's producing whatever 10,000 events, right? You go take a short break, you walk, come back. The HEPMC file is made, right? And then you run your analysis on that. So that's a serial process. Now, in heavy irons, let's say you want to look for, you know, Z primes or whatever it is, 10,000 events is not going to cut it, right? You have to generate lots and lots and lots and lots of events. So when you do that, there is a cost associated with it. In fact, there are two costs. There is a time cost and a storage cost. If the only thing you're after is the output from the Rivet analysis, then it's kind of wasted to run all of the object, all of the event generation, save your HEPMC files, and that will have some, you know, tens of gigabytes of storage on a cluster. If you're lucky, if it's a heavy ion event, you know, if it's like a hydro event, then it's like hundreds of gigabytes for how many ever thousand, you know, tens of hundreds of thousands of events you want to run. And then you run your analysis on it, and it just takes time, right? And space in your disk space. There is a way in which you can do this, and we are not going to do it today. We will possibly try and do it next week, right? Is use feedback. Is you can tell JETSCAPE to write to the event file one by one. You write one event. The moment it makes an event, it writes it to the output FMC file. Then Rivet runs in the background. It will look at that file. The moment one event is in that file, Rivet will read that event and then run the event, you know, the analyze function there, and then wait. Hold everything, hold all the histograms and stuff in memory, right? And then that file gets deleted. And well, the file becomes empty. Then Rivet puts in another event, and then this guy reads it. And then he puts another event, and then this guy reads it, right? So JETSCAPE and Rivet keep talking like that. So you kind of skip this intermediate step. It's still, you know, one after another, but it's one after another, event by event, right? So there are ways in which you can do this, and you can also use this and run it for multiple types of analysis that you want, not just full. And you can do, like, you know, centrality calibration on this stuff. You can do all different kinds of correlation studies that are being put into Rivet right now. But for now, let's do this the old-fashioned way, right? We run JETSCAPE, create our events, and then run Rivet on them to basically analyze it. Okay, so I'm going to look at this JETSCAPE FIFO XML. Where's my emacs? Let me go into my JETSCAPE. Here. So JETSCAPE FIFO and then config JETSCAPE FIFO.xml. So this is not the default one that you get because I have already made changes to it. And you can see inside, if you go to the tutorial, we put in this JETSCAPE FIFO.xml in there. So you can just do cat JETSCAPE FIFO.xml. This is all the thing that's in there. You can copy it and you can paste it into that. But the only difference is you can see here, we change the number of events. Right now, let's just do 100 events, right? So that things are simple. The output name, my FMC output. In this case, we turned off the FIFO part of it, right? Because I told you we're going to do it kind of old standard way. So just turn on the JETSCAPE FMC writer. For the hard process, we are going to run, you know, in this Pythia, PT hat min 4, max 40, center of mass energy 200. So this is RIC energy, kind of a low energy spectrum. In vacuum is turned on. So we're running PP collisions here, right? And that's it. That's all. Very simple XML file. So now I go into my JETSCAPE and then build. And you can see I've already run this and I already built it. So I'm just going to do run JETSCAPE. And then I'm going to do home. Config JETSCAPE FIFO.xml. All right, so it ran. It gave me my output file. You can see here my FMC output. It's a pretty small file. I can look into it. You can see FMC version, blah, blah, blah. This is the energy that they used to produce. This is the weight of the event. There's some general cross-section in units that Rivet will know to pick up, right? And these are a line for heavy iron. We are not generating heavy iron. That's why this is all zero, right? And you can see a list of particles, vertices, blah, this all happens in information. It's very annoying to read, right? We can let Rivet do that job. So let's go into our Rivet analysis directory. And Here we go. So I'm back in the place where I made my executable. So the way we're going to run it, Rivet minus A and the name of the analysis without the CC. So just my first analysis. And we are going to add a few things here. We're going to add this flag, dash dash PWD, because Rivet has its own internal analysis path. It comes with a whole bunch of, if you didn't change the name of the HEPMC file in your, like you can see this output file name, I just changed it to my HEPMC output, Archita. So it's fine. If you have it, if you didn't change it, you would probably get my FIFO.HEPMC. Then as long as it's filled and it looks like what I showed you, you're fine. Yeah, so you can see here, we did the Rivet minus A, name of the analysis, inside minus A. And we tell Rivet to look for this analysis library in this path, right? I so far only talked about the .cc. We haven't talked about the .plot and the .info. We'll get to it later. We still have time. So we tell Rivet, look in this directory. If you don't do that, it will go through all its internal directories and it will say, I never heard of this analysis. You're trying to fool me, right? But we just have to tell it, look at where you are. That's what this dash dash PWD means. There are other ways you can do this. You can set the analysis path to a certain directory. I just like to do it this way because it's simple, right? And then we tell it where the HEPMC file is, right? So we do slash, home, JETSCAPE, Rivet user. These things. And then it's inside this thing, slash build, slash, that's the name of my file. All right, so this is the HEPMC file is going to run over. And then I do dash O, and then I say output.yoda file. We can make it more descriptive. Output pp200gev.yoda. That is the output of this particular Rivet analysis. Okay, I'm going to run this. You can already tell how impatient I am. Come on, Docker, do your job. All right. Aha, it complained. This is the annoying thing in Rivet. They have this thing where they check the beams, right? And there's this internal consistency code. And when we run heavy ions mainly, right, we run lead on lead or gold on gold or whatever it is, right? It'll just annoyingly complain. We'll get past it. So it's telling you it's running Rivet on this machine. It's trying to read this tree from here. It tried to read the root tree for HEPMC. It can also read the root output, right? But now it's trying to attempt to read the ASCII part, right? Which is the text version. It's saying a warning, using this analysis is unvalidated. Of course it's unvalidated, we just made it, right? But it's telling you to be careful because it's not validated by the Rivet experts. So when you have official analysis, the Rivet experts essentially, Andy and others have blessed this, right? Those analyses don't get this warning. But we're just trying to make charge spectrum. It's fine, right? So we have to get out of this issue. So the way we do that is you can add another flag, ignore beams. Now you can ask me, we are running PP. Why does this show up? I don't know. At this point, I don't really care about the beams. So I always put this and run it. And this should be there in our tutorial. There you go, you can see here, ignore beams. Aha, see, we forced it to do what we wanted to do. So it read events from this hepmc file. It ran over 100 events very, very fast because we're doing nothing basically. It tells you the cross section in picobarns. And now let's see what we have. We created this yoda file, output pp.yoda. So this is now the yoda format. Right, it's a histogram one dimension, and this is the cross section, so it's scaled by the cross section. Right, it tells you the mean value, the area. This is the x low, x high, so this is the bin boundaries. These are different sum of weights, so sum of weight squared, number of entries that went into each bin. Right, so this is basically your histogram of the charged particle spectrum. Now, if you want to make that plot, we have to do something and fix this Python version that I talked about. Oh, we have an interesting error. So Jonghan says, did you include your dash dash PWD? This option. Could you copy and paste your actual code that you ran, that you got the error? Interesting. Your code to wait, is your analysis built? Like you have this library, right? Did you do the Rivet build? Anytime you make changes to your analysis code, you have to build it and create this library. Yeah, let's try that one. Okay, so we now have our it could be from this, seems like, did you have to define your histograms in here, Archita. So let me go back to the analysis code. So you have the booking method for the histogram. That's in the first case. You fill it here. And you need this part, map string histop 1D pointer. You normalize it. And then you build your analysis such that you get the library. If you just copy and paste everything I have in here, right, inside this, that you already got in your this, my first analysis.cc, this should compile. So you can directly copy and paste this and see what differences do you have with yours and this one. Okay, so let's try and debug it on that end. All right, so we looked at the output. We have the Yoda file. So what we are going to do next, as I said, is include root in here. And we are lucky because the JETSCAPE package comes with root, right? That Docker comes with root installed, right? You can do which root, and it's right here, right? So there's a very simple way to build root inside Rivet. So we're going to create a new analysis. So everyone remember how we did the new analysis, right? My first root analysis. This time we have to be careful because this is not enough to compile it. I'll show you why. So let's go back to this place. We have our my first root analysis. And let's start from the headers. I am going to create tfile.h. I'm going to include th1.h, right? So root output file and a one-dimensional histogram. That's what I want, okay? And everything else I can, right? I don't need to include any of this stuff, right? And then I'm going to go pretty fast because we've already talked about this. Until we get to the histogram part. So this is what we used, right? How do we define root histogram? Let's just comment this out and then say my new root histograms. So usually when we declare the histograms, we do th1f h. I always do underscore h charged pt. It's new th1f, and then copy this, paste it here. And then this is the name. And then this is the binning that I can just copy. And we did 10.0, right? You should not do this, right? Because you are declaring, see where you're declaring this pointer? Inside the init method. Once you declare this thing inside the init method, you will lose it inside the analyze. It goes out of scope, right? So what we are going to do is copy this part and then go here and then say, this is a private member. And then declare it in the class. Then all members of the class have access to this. Outside objects don't have access, right? Because it's private. You can make it public, but then why do you want to make it public? You know, private's fine, right? We're going to do the same thing for tfile. I'm going to call it fout, right? And then we are going to initialize them here. Well, usually it's good to do the output file and then the histogram. So underscore f out is new d file. And I'm going to make it recreate every time. And then I'm going to call rivet output histogram.root. All right, now we have created our root output file and our root histogram. And we have declared them as private objects, private members in the class. We have initialized them here. And then fs particles, fs, and then we kill this one. We can just go here and copy the code to make things simpler because nothing else changes. All right, so now the only difference is that we don't have this Yoda histogram naming convention, right? So we use the name of our histogram. And in root, you all know that you have to use capital F to fill things because root wanted it that way. And you also can't normalize it this way, but you can use the scale function in root. And the way we do that is we take our histogram, and let's comment this out. We do histogram scale 1 divided by the cross-section in picobonds. Right, but we're not done. We have to write it to the output file. So we take the object for the output file, we cd into it, and now we say this one write, and then we close the output file. And we don't need this anymore. We can just kill this one. All right, everyone with me? Good. So we used root, we hacked that into Rivet. Now let's try and compile it. Let's try and build the analysis. Let's just try this thing, see what it tells us. See? It didn't know where T file is. It has no idea about any root include files. There's a very simple way in which you can do this. You go to your analysis README, and in the root object, you copy this part right here. You can use the root config, which when you install something, you can use the Rivet config, the root config. It tells you the configuration that was used, right? You can ask it for the C flags that tell you where the include stuff is and where the libraries are listed, and it will add it to this command. It will add it at the very end here, and I'll show you. You can see this is where we stop, right? And then we add all of the flags necessary for root. That include the root include, the root libraries, you know, T physics, T matrix, T thread, root data frame, blah, blah, blah. It includes everything. And then it worked. There you go. You have your analysis now that you can play with. So now let's run it in exactly the same way. And I'm going to, this time, we are not writing to a Yoda file, but Rivet will make a Yoda file. If you run Rivet, it'll make one. So I just like to call it dummy.yoda. So I know for myself that it's useless. And then in this case, I just change the name to Rivet-A, my first root analysis, dash dash pwd, ignore beans, the name of the output file, the name of the input hepmc file, and I run it. All right, it's done. Let's see what we have. We have our root histogram file. We also have a dummy Yoda, because I told you it's going to create one. So how do we look at this? So I usually just go to another directory outside the Docker container, another terminal outside the Docker container. See, this is here. And this is my root on my Mac that I installed with Homebrew. and I can do my root rivet output histograms. I can create a new T browser, and then I forgot that this thing always, oh God, it's so annoying. This new root and its annoying web browser stuff. So I have to add this to it. And there you go. Now we can do all kinds of fun things with it. There's your root histogram that you have created from essentially PP spectra from within JETSCAPE, charged particle spectra, right? And that's it. Yeah, so now we can do all kinds of fun stuff that we want, right? We can go here, we can add, you know, we can add new histograms. We can create jet spectrum. Yes, okay. So if you go into, I assume you got the tutorial directory. So inside the tutorial directory, I have copied and pasted my root analysis in there, my first root analysis, so you can compare your code. All right, so that is analysis style number two. The first analysis we ran in order to get just a YODA file, right? Second one we ran with the root file. The third one, we are going to use it from data that already exists, right? Especially the star paper. I'm going to copy this one. That's the Inspire link. And then I'm going to go here and Inspire and then see. Okay. This paper. The identified hadron spectra at large transverse momentum in PP and D-Gold collisions at star. And this has HEP data, right? So if I go to its HEP data, I lost my Slack. All right, come on. Yes. You can see the first table is, what does it say? Transverse momentum distribution of pi plus production in D-Gold minimum bias events, right? We don't want D-Gold, we want PP. Here we go. Table two, transverse momentum distribution of pi plus production in PP events at mid rapidity region, rapidity less than 0.5, okay? And here's the data points. It has its own binning. So let's see if we can make a comparison to this guy. Right, we won't be able to see the plot because of the Python issue that I told you, but we can already make it so that next week we can do the comparison. So let's go back to our terminal. CD rivet analysis. So before I start this, any other question on the root aspect? Andy Buckley will hate me for telling you, he's a good friend. I can tell him for telling you to always ignore it. It's fine. As long as you wrote the analysis, it's fine, right? Because it's on you. If someone else writes your analysis, I kind of sound like a TSA agent. Did someone else give you something to run in your analysis? Right? In that case, you have to be careful. You know, if you trust me and I've given you code, then it's okay. Because once the Rivet people bless your analysis, then it will be significantly useful. Well, because it'll go along with the analysis stuff. Ah, the flag to turn off the root web browser. Well, I just copied and pasted what it told me. Revert to T browser by starting root with dash dash web off. Yeah. I have no idea what this. Oh, no, this is the thing that I killed. That's fine. All right, so we're going to do something fun here. So we're going to do Rivet make analysis. And we're going to follow this criterion here. So we're going to go to Inspire, and the Inspire tag is this, right? And this paper came out in 2006 from STAR, right? So we're going to do Rivet make analysis STAR 2006. I followed by the tag. So watch what happens when I do this. You can see it got Inspire's data for this paper. So if I now do ls minus alrth, I not only have the info, the plot, and the CC, I also have a Yoda file. Oh, this is just me not saving it. This code. Yeah, that's gone. I also have a .yoda file, right? So let me look at this Yoda file. So D1, X1, Y1. This is the first table. And the first table we know to be the, where is it? Here. Table one is D gold events, right? So that's this data right here. And this is table two. This is the PP data. This is what we want to compare to, right? So this is where we are going to use our, our next type of histogram booking is directly from the HEP data. So because this analysis didn't exist from STAR, like STAR didn't officially send this analysis to Rivet. So that's why you're still getting a default analysis thing here. But STAR did make this because we used this Rivet analysis for our Pythia 8 Detroit tune, right? For our tuning purposes. So I'm going to go to our Pythia underlying event tune for Rick and code. It shows you our GitHub code page. Start 2006. What is this guy? I 709170 right here. So this is our code to make this histogram. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to directly copy this file. I can paste this one in the Slack chat. So I'm going to go to raw, I'm going to copy this file, and I'm going to go into my analysis here, kill it, paste it. Now, let's go through what's in this code. So all of this is basically the same thing, right? We have the analysis, we have a projection for charged final state. We also have a projection for the identified particle because we wanted, you know, pi pluses, right? For example, this measurement also had pi on k on proton in STAR. So we fit it to the histograms like the pi plus, pi minus, right? So you can see We have the identified particle, final state, the pion state. We have a proton state, and I said for the pion, accept ID pair. Actually, we only want the pion, right? So let's make it simple. I'm going to kill the proton. I don't want the proton. So I'm only going to have this pion, final state, right? So here's my absolute value eta selection. This is much larger, obviously, than our experiment. We will cut it down later. I mean, you could also cut it down here. PT greater than 0.3 GeV, right? And we want only the ones with the PID of pi plus, right? So then you declare your final state projection. You call it pion. You book a histogram that only has the PT pi plus 211. That's from the HEP data table number 2, right? Everything else, I don't care. I'm going to kill it right now. You can only do a single thing, even from a data. You don't have to do everything, right? And here we go. Identified particle final state, pion final state. You do the projection. You have a particle loop. If the absolute value of the rapidity of the particle is less than 0.5, that was the experimental selection, right? And we can say the PT is whatever this value of the PT divided in GeV, right? And if the charge is greater than zero, you fill this pi plus. If not, you fill the pi minus. This is just a fancy way of writing an if-else statement. We don't need to do this fancy business. We can just say if there you go. Right? You fill in the histogram, but now this is a Yoda histogram, right? We're not using root at this point. We're using the binning derived from our HEP data. We fill the Yoda, so it's small f. And the experimental measurement is filled in with 1/PT as a weight for the value every time you do it. So that is in here as well, okay? Everything else, we don't care. And then there's some measurements here that I forgot to do one thing. Let me have this one. This is useful. Because we divide by the sum of weights in this case, and that sum of selected events that we run. So I'm going to copy and paste that. Yeah, I'm just going to copy and paste this thing in here. This just fills in. This is like a counter, right? So it selects the sum of weights that we have done. And every time we run an event, we fill this in, right? You can also do that, Achita. So from inside the tutorial, it's actually not the same one. So the one in the tutorial was done by Crystal yesterday. I'm just kind of doing it hands-on here. I'm using the one that was done in the official analysis, copying and pasting it here, and then just killing the stuff that I don't want, right? You can also use Crystal's version and play with it. So we are essentially, you know, in the playing part of the tutorial, right? We can make whatever observable you want at this point. So the measurement also does a ratio of pi plus over pi minus. So if you have two histograms, you can divide them in Rivet and then store them in the scatter plot. This is how you do it. You can do proton, antiproton ratios, all of that stuff. We don't want any of that. We just want pi plus. And there's some C out statements. I'm going to kill all the other ones. Only have pi plus. Yeah, that's it. Let's save this. And then let me, what I can do to make your life simpler is I can go to the tutorial directory, add a new file, paste this here, and then say, official.cc. Well, I guess I should also be consistent and then have this official also here. So I put it in the in this repository. So you can have this is Christelle's version from yesterday. You can see she did pi plus, pi minus, and she also did the ratio. I only did the pi plus version, right? And I have done a thing that I usually don't do, is I put it into GitHub without checking if it compiles, because things have been going so great in this tutorial. Let's see if it compiles. Rivet build IVET, name of the analysis, .so, and then .cc. Well, would you look at that? It actually compiled. Good job. So if I go into my directory, I have the new library, right? So I can do rivet minus a, and it's a long command, so I'm just going to find where I did it before and just copy and paste this. And now it's not dummy. Now it's actually comparing to data, right? So we can do rec pp 200 pi plus spectra compared star data dot yoda. But this way, when you come back to your root to your yoda file, you know exactly what it is. Okay, come on, guys. Let's see. Hey, nice. So it ran. It still says it's unvalidated because we didn't officially send it, but we star validated it and we made it public, right? We should send it to Andy, and that's my fault. And I told them, but I didn't officially submit the request. But okay, here we go. We have the histograms are written to this Yoda file. Let's take a look. So this is our Monte Carlo histogram. And then this is the raw data histogram. You can see here. Right? So when we use Rivet, we should be able to directly compare it to each other, right? So when we use this make plots, it will complain right now, but we are trying to fix it. Hopefully by next Wednesday, we will have it fixed. It's a very funny Python mismatch version. But yeah. So if you have the data file in the histogram, you can throw this histogram to a root file and directly compare the two. So that is basically all I have planned for today, guys. And I think we are very good on time. It's we have 15 more minutes left. So if you have any further questions, I'm here and others are here too, please. So hopefully this was a bit of a easy-ish tutorial for everyone to follow and run on their own. And I can promise you that next time will be a little bit more complicated. And we will run heavy irons, we will run centrality calibration, and we can also do jet substructure. So if you go to this link that I posted for the star tune, there is an analysis here from 2021. This is the jet mass, right? So we have the mass in various bins of jet momentum, and we get the final list of particles. So this is mainly for Yasuke and Archita who are asking. You can define your fast jet selectors for different radii, individually run your soft drop on each of them. You get your jets, you run your cluster sequence on top of it, and you can fill the histograms that you extracted, and you will get something that looks like this. Where's the plot? Here we go. This pi plus plot that we were talking about, it will look exactly like this one right here in the paper. And if you do the jet mass, it will look like this. Oh, this is a groomed mass selection, whatever. So you can go and play with any of these links. So Archita, I just see a question. Which commands exactly are you talking about? You can unmute yourself and then ask. Maybe it's a bit of a longer question. Yeah, I can't hear you. This is missing in the README. That's my fault. I was just trying to see how far we will get in this README, so I'll definitely put it in there. I can do it relatively easily now as we are discussing. And I already put the code in there, so we can directly do Rivet make analysis. Here we go. All right, that's basically it. Everything else is exactly the same. Building it, you don't need this root config, so just build it like how you did the previous one. Rivet build just like that. And then the running is exactly the same. Yeah, compiling any analysis When you make your analysis, it will tell you how to compile it. So for everything that does not use root, just use exactly what they tell you. The only way to change this, and if you want to use root, you can use the thing that we gave here with this root config flags. And what this means, because it's native C++ compilation, right? So you can add any external library that you want, as long as you have built it with the same GCC and, you know, the same versions. So I don't know, if you want to use Seagal, or Boost is already here, but if you want to use some fancy neural network library that you want, I don't know why you would do that, but if you want to, you can include it and run it. All right, so anything else? We have 10 minutes. Looks like you're all excellent today. No issues. Very little comments, very little questions on Slack.
And you were excellent too, Raghav. Thank you very much for the talk and the hands-on sessions and for taking the questions one by one and answering them with detail. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Maybe we can give a few more seconds or a minute for people to ask questions. And if not, maybe we can
continue. We still have a bit more time. I'm here. So if you have any more questions, you can definitely ask.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you so much. And sending you virtual applause.
Thank you.